Thank you. Thank you very much. And welcome once again to another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling. I might just point out, of course, that later on in the program, we're going to be hearing from the World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion, Ric Flair. Also, we'll be hearing from the American Dream, Dusty Rhodes. We'll be watching Brian Blair and Bruno Sammartino in action in a tag team match. We'll be seeing Steve-O in action. Also, a newcomer, although we have seen him on videotape, this will be our first time to see him in person. He will be accompanied by his manager and mentor, if you will, Mr. Gary Hart. We're talking about the fabulous Kabuki. And as you can see, Terry Gordy has joined me. He and Superfly Snook are the former Georgia Tag Team Champions. That title is currently held by Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk.
Well, that's right, Sully. You know, there's a whole lot of excitement happening over the Georgia area. And it's like this. Anytime the kid's in town, you know there's going to be excitement going down. But, you know, I got a good friend, Gordon Sully. He's been gone for a few weeks. And he likes to cause a little excitement himself, and I'm sure all y'all people out there remember his name. It's Big Jim Duggan. And that is Duggan. That's not Dugan. And Duggan is coming back to the area to cause a little pandemonium because he likes to cause pandemonium just like myself. Duggan has been taking a little tour. He's been all around the world. He's been to Japan, Puerto Rico, Dominica. If there's a Rica, he's been there too, Gordon.
Well, indeed, Big Jim Duggan, who will be returning very shortly, obviously, here to the Georgia Championship Wrestling scene. And I assume now that Snook is gone that you're going to take him on.
That's right. No, Sully, Snook is going to be back. Snook is off with an injury right now. You know, in any sport, you can have an injury a little. It's just nothing to worry about, nothing to get upset over. He will be back. Snook is looking forward to coming back, and he's going to cause a little pandemonium, too. You know, Gordon Sully, now these are the type of people that I like to hang with. It's not Michael Hayes. I don't like to hang with people like that, such as Michael Hayes, you know, who gets out here and he wants to insult everybody on the TV and everything. Well, Michael Hayes, you can go on and you can insult me all you want to, boy, but that's all you can do.
Well, obviously, of course, Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk, the new Georgia Tag Team Champions, having defeated this man, Terry Gordy, and Superfly Jim Snuka for that title. And naturally, I can understand why you would like to regain that championship, be it with Big Jim Duggan or whether it's Superfly Snuka.
Well, it's not just what's this. What's this?
Now, you know, I was standing back in the monitor room, and I was listening to you shoot off your mouth, and I can't believe how much on this television you look like a big baby. So what I did is I found something back there that I thought I might give you. You see this little bonnet here, little cute baby bonnet? I thought that might look real good upside of that fat face of yours out here.
Let me tell you something, boy. I bet you
wait
wish you was mad enough to put it
well,
on me.
Hold on, hold on, gentlemen.
See, that's what I'm talking about.
We'll be back. We'll be back. We'll be back in just a moment. Let's go to a commercial here. Let's go. Well,
Gordon Sully, did you see what happened?
Yeah, I saw what happened. I saw it. We've got a match. Yeah, I understand that. We've got a match. Let's go to that match right now. All right, an Australian tag team event. Brian Blair and Bruno Sammartino going up against a combination here of Don Gilbert and Jose Medina. And that is Medina out there right now against Brian Blair. Brian Blair, University of Louisville, went there on an athletic scholarship. He was All-State in amateur wrestling. Bruno Sammartino, of course, a second-generation wrestler. His father, who just recently retired. And the tag is made. Brian Blair tags up with Bruno Sammartino Jr. And Sammartino catches his man very nicely. Drop toe hold, floats up the body, catches into an arm bar. And so Gilbert has his problems now. Tag is made once again. It is Brian Blair moving in. Full arm drag and twist now. And so Gilbert on the canvas on one knee. He's in the dark blue trunks going up against Brian Blair, light blue trunks. Gilbert reverses that situation, but Brian Blair breaks it up. Both feet into the chest. Here comes Jose Medina, San Juan, Puerto Rico. Tag is made. Bruno Sammartino out of Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, in the green trunk. Catches Medina in the back with the knee, then goes back to the arm bar. And so both Brian Blair and Sammartino have been concentrating on the left arm of both of their opponents thus far. Brings his man back with a chin lock, back to the canvas. Into an arm drag takedown again. And so Medina turns into his man. Tried to move in, and it is a good move by Sammartino Jr. Flat drop to the canvas, into a drop toe hold. Medina makes it into the ropes, and the referee calls for the break. And Sammartino makes the tag. Brian Blair, off that second rope, drives a flat of the foot into the shoulder, the deltoid area of Jose Medina. Medina back to the canvas once again. Turns that to his own advantage. Good drop toe hold by Medina. Makes the tag with Don Gilbert. And so Gilbert moves into a side headlock on Brian Blair. Short chopping right hand, Gilbert with a forearm. And it is Brian Blair retaliating. Brian Blair catches him again. Brian Blair, another beautiful bolo-like forearm that time that has Gilbert staggered. Those eyes rolled skyward momentarily. Full body slam on Gilbert. Hurdles his man in, and it was Sammartino, a clubbing right hand as Gilbert hit the turnbuckle at the same time. And it is Sammartino, a knee to the side of the head. Sammartino brings him up. Scooped into a full body slam. Now Sammartino crashes down across his chest once again. Gilbert powers out before the count of three, but Sammartino and Brian Blair have kept up a constant onslaught on Gilbert and Jose Medina. Gilbert put on the ropes. Sammartino brings him back up, uses the back of the elbow to the base of the skull of Don Gilbert, makes the tag. Brian Blair moves into the ring. Sammartino, using an arm whip, sends him off the ropes. It is Jose Medina breaking up a pinning combination that time. Brian Blair catches him, a good forearm on Medina. Back to Gilbert. Blair, short body slam, crashes down, and it was Gilbert rolling to one side, and Blair could be in trouble. He came down on the point of that elbow. Gilbert, short, chopping hard right hand. Now the elbow to the side of the head. Tags up with Medina once again. Medina, and that was dangerously close to the point of the boot. And Medina unloading some heavy artillery now on Brian Blair. Has Blair into the ring ropes, into the turnbuckle in his own corner. Referee George Scott Jr. trying to separate them. Here's Sammartino Jr. come charging across the ring. It is Medina and Gilbert both double teaming on Brian Blair. Brian Blair caught with a side headlock. Blair caught again. Blair catches one, and it is Blair firing back. Caught him just under the rib tree. Rolling reverse, beautiful move. Into almost a block saddle, and it was Blair making the tag with Bruno Sammartino. Blair made that tag, steps outside the ring, and Sammartino Jr. moving very quickly on Gilbert. Catches him, a ripping right hand, one to the midsection. Lefts and rights to the series of them now. As Gilbert in trouble, then a high knee lift to the side of the head. Gilbert drops to one knee. High backdrop puts Gilbert back to the canvas once again. Another full body slam by San Martino, and San Martino moving very, very aggressively. Jose Medina tried to reach out and break that up, but Gilbert was able to power out anyway. Once again, off the ropes, Bruno Sammartino, a good shoulder smash. Sammartino, and Gilbert caught him that time. Good block and a good finesse move by Bruno Sammartino. Had him into a rope. No, sir. Shoulder was off. Gilbert rolled away from a possible pinning combination there. Again, the tag is made. Jose Medina moves in, and Bruno Sammartino caught with a couple of forearms by Medina. Medina has Sammartino Jr. up, a full body slam. Medina now the flat of the foot to the back of the, to the back itself, rather. The tag is made. Brian Blair moves back in. Brian Blair, a series of forearms to the side of the head. Brian Blair. Started into a variation of a banana split. Medina broke it up. Good move by Blair, but a good counter by Medina. Off the ropes, and this time it's Blair. Went for the standing guillotine. Moved it into a banana split. Pinning combination from the guillotine to a banana split. He had those shoulders down for the count of three. And so, a very, very fine victory indeed for Bruno Sammartino Jr. and for Brian Blair. Well, a couple of moments ago, as you saw, Terry Gordy was out here talking with me, and Michael Hayes came out. There was some discussion about a baby bonnet, if you will. Well, I didn't know exactly what all might take place. I didn't know how involved these men were going to get, because both of them have pretty volatile tempers. And I did get word from our director, however, that we did catch the action. Even though they cut away to a commercial, we did catch some action that I think all of you at home are certainly entitled to see. For those of you here in the studio audience, you saw what happened. But let's take a look now as Michael Hayes and Terry Gordy have their confrontation.
Wait a second, Terry Gordy, they're putting the... They put a baby bonnet on him, and they shoved a baby bottle in his mouth. Wow.
Well, that's what happened that those of you at home did not get an opportunity to see Terry Gordy came out.
Wait just a second, Gordon. Sorry, I don't appreciate it one little bit. You showing this film back on nationwide TV. I don't appreciate being treated like this, Gordon Sully. I'm a professional athlete, and I want to be treated like a professional athlete. It's like this, Gordon Sully. Michael's been going around here and calling me names and calling me everything for a long time now, and I'm getting good and tired of it. You know, it's like this, Michael Hayes. I don't know if you're anywhere back there listening or not, boy, but I got something to tell you, and I want you to clean your ears up and clean them out good, boy. It's like this. I bet you can't. I bet he ain't man enough, Gordon Sully. I bet he ain't man enough to take this bottle and take this bonnet and stick it in my mouth itself, you know. Gordon Sully, if I could only get my hands on him right now, I would beat him like a red-headed stepchild, because Michael Hayes, I ain't ever got your body, boy. And one day, Michael Hayes, I'm going to pay you back, boy, because, you know, I did a lot of things for you. I brought you out of the slums of Pensacola, Florida, and made you what you are today. So, Michael Hayes, you know, it's like this, Gordon Sully. You just don't do something like this and embarrass me on nationwide TV and think for 1 second that you're going to get away with it. Because, Michael Hayes, if it takes everything I got, boy, I'm going to beat every brain in your body out.
Well, perhaps one day they will meet one-on-one, and we'll find out who is the better man, Michael Hayes or Terry Gordy. We'll be right back. I really suppose I shouldn't smile or chuckle over the situation with Terry Gordy. It happened a moment ago, but I can't help but feel that he did look somewhat ludicrous with that knitted baby bonnet and that baby bottle in his mouth. Might just point out, of course, that we were talking about that, and I'd like to remind you once again, of course, that Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk are indeed the Georgia Tag Team Champions. Now, let's go to Freddie Miller and take a look at where wrestling is being held all around this great country of ours. Freddie?
Thanks, Gordon. On Sunday, October 25th, Columbus, Ohio at 7:30 at the Ohio Center. Tickets now on sale at the center at all five major Columbus Lazarus stores. That afternoon in Huntington, West Virginia, 2 o'clock at the Memorial Fieldhouse. A great card of Battle Royal to meet the world champion that day at the Fieldhouse. On the 24th, Piedmont, Alabama, the high school. The 23rd, Cartersville, Georgia, the Cherokee Street Gym. The 22nd, Cleveland, Georgia, Truett McConnell Gym. On the 21st, Columbus, Georgia. The 20th, Dawsonville, Georgia. Next Saturday, Carrollton, Georgia. Next Friday, Gainesville, Georgia, the Georgia Mountain Center, and Gunnersville, Alabama. Next Thursday, Hawkinsville and Trenton, Georgia. Tuesday, Thomaston, Georgia. Monday night, Augusta Bell Auditorium. Tomorrow night at 8, that's Marietta, the Cobb County Civic Center. Tomorrow at 3, Chattanooga. Tonight, the Coliseum in Gadsden, Alabama, and Rockmar, Georgia. Here's the full card for the Omni next Sunday, the 18th. Watch. Attention wrestling fans, on the 18th, such stars as Otis Sistrunk, and many more, including Big Jim Duggan against Steve-O, Midgets Match, Little Tokyo against Cowboy Lang, George Wells against the Great Kabuki, and the grudge match of the year, Michael Hayes against Terry Gordy. Tag team event, it's now Wildfire Tommy Rich and a mystery partner against Tor Kamata, managed by the Great Mephisto and Ray Stevens. And for the World Heavyweight Championship, Nature Boy Ric Flair champion against the American Dream Dusty Rhodes. Get your tickets early for great seats, the Omni Atlanta.
Steve-O moving against Professor Sonata. Steve-O, by the way, outstanding athlete, as is Sonata. Sonata, who has been well-schooled in the martial arts. He's from Japan, exceptionally dangerous man. Steve-O from Minnesota, from Edina, Minnesota, to be more correct. Steve-O from, with a family with an outstanding history in professional athletics. His dad, a pro football player. His brother, a pro football player. Steve-O, who has his degree in teaching, but has been a devotee of amateur wrestling and pro wrestling. Sonoda, exceptionally dangerous. Good. Duck under, go behind. A lateral drop and heel block takedown by Steve-O. Steve-O has great speed. And notice the defensive stance of Steve-O. Now, I'll tell you more about that later on. I don't wish to pass along any knowledge about Steve-O and some of the things that he has been doing recently to further sharpen and hone his skills in this sport. But with his permission, perhaps next week, I might be able to bring you some more information on that. However, this and it is a Sonata catching him, a quick chop alongside the neck. Steve-O, good shoulder smash, drops Sonata to the canvas. Steve-O moves in on him once again, gets a side headlock. And Sonata tried to set him that time. Steve-O, using his body weight and momentum, was able to carry him into a takedown. Sonata tried to roll him into a pinning combination, could not do so. Referee George Scott Jr. watching carefully now as Steve-O keeps that side headlock. Sonata, as most all Japanese wrestlers, began his early training with purely the Oriental style of martial arts, the karate and jiu-jitsu, judo, many variations of it. Whereas Kamata who's managed by the great Mephisto, had most of his early training in sumo wrestling, which is all primarily upper body, weight, balance, and leverage. It's amazing how Japanese wrestlers and any of the wrestlers from the Orient can adapt so easily to the American catch-as-catch-can style. They have, I think, perhaps, a slightly easier time of it here than they do in Europe, where they are a little more trouble adapting to the European style of wrestling. And good blocks by, notice how Sonoda. Very defensive posture. All right, collar and elbow once again. Steve-O now with a side headlock. Steve-O keeping that side headlock on Sonoda. And chopped in the midsection, Steve-O chopped. And look at the, again, I call attention to the rather unusual and unique defensive posture of Steve-O. And I say, of course, at this point, I would feel obligated to say nothing further, but you're watching something very, very interesting between these two. A challenge of a different nature, if you will. And now suddenly Sonoda exploding on Steve-O, and Steve-O retaliating very quickly. Came off that second rope into a beautiful hip lock takedown. Steve-O with a side headlock, and it is Sonoda catching the hair, breaking up the side headlock, and Sonoda, quick chop into the chest, another chop into the back of Steve-O. Sonoda, a ripping chop across the throat, another one into the side of the jaw. And Steve-O has his problems now. Utilizing the turnbuckles in that corner very effectively, Steve-O, the recipient of a lot of punishment here. Direct thrust into the throat now by Sonoda. And Steve-O coming up very slowly. Steve-O trying to take Sonoda on at his own style, his own tactical advantage, and finding out that Sonoda will carry an edge in that division. There's no question about that. And Steve-O caught again by Sonoda. Sonoda now punishing Steve-O, drives him back into those ring ropes. And it is Sonoda. Again, a forearm across the base of the skull of Steve-O. Steve-O caught him in the sleeper. Caught him in that Japanese sleeper hold, an American variation of the Japanese sleeper. And has it in full force into the ropes. Into the ropes, and Sonoda was able to break free from it. So Sonoda, as we've said before, extremely well-versed, using perhaps one of the few methods of breaking that Japanese sleeper. Steve-O in trouble now as Sonoda continues to punish him. Another chop across the base of the skull of Steve-O. Sonoda moving in, and Sonoda might taste that... Might hint that scent, that smell of victory coming in with. Missed with that chop, and Steve-O, beautiful savant-like blow with the foot by Steve-O. Steve-O catches him again. Drove into the midsection, one to the side of the head, Steve-O into the lateral press. And it was Sonoda coming up slowly, but enough in time to break from that three count. Caught him again, and that looked very much, I couldn't tell from this camera angle, but it certainly looked like a double thrust to the throat. And it is Steve-O, and again, notice he used the foot again, the flat of the foot this time. And again, Steve-O puts him to the canvas, hooks the near leg, add him to a cradle, but it was Sonoda breaking away. Steve-O brings him up, atomic knee drop, into a lateral press. No, sir, Sonoda powers out again before the count of three. And Steve-O going outside the ring. Now, wait a minute, Sonoda coming up very slowly. Steve-O poised atop the top ring rope. Full body press. Count of three.
a count of three. And it was all over for Professor Sonoda. Steve O, using a full body press, actually a cross body block, coming off that top ring rope to score the pinfall on Professor Sonoda. But some unusual movements by Steve O, and when we get a chance to talk to him, I'm going to ask him further about that. You know, in all of the years that I have been associated with professional wrestling, a most unusual situation occurred this past week. I got a phone call from the superstar. He said he had something very, very important on his mind, and would I fly to Atlanta and meet with him, that he wanted to make sure that a message was carried back to Tommy Rich. So I want to bring Tommy Rich out here if I can, and talk to him about the situation. And then I'm going to show you a very, very interesting piece of film. It evolves around a conversation I had with the superstar. And with some other people that were with the superstar.
Look here, Gordon. Look here what I got with me. Get a close-up of that box. Mephisto! Kamada! Ray Steven. Right there it is. Look at there. You know, Tommy Rich ain't by himself. Tommy Rich ain't standing here by himself no more, Gordon. I said I was going to go out and get a mystery man, and I got me a mystery man.
All right. Well, of course, I've had an opportunity to explain to Tommy exactly what did happen during the week, but I think it's only fair to show all of you who are viewing right now exactly what did happen. I flew into Atlanta. I met with a superstar he had with him. Some other people. Well, let's take a look at this conversation.
Yes, I came here at your request, but there's not a thing that I can do for you.
Gordon, I don't want you to do a thing for me. All I want you to do is, because I know that Tommy Rich respects you a great deal, and I've respected you in the past, I want you to take back a message, and this is directed to you, Tommy Rich. You have cost me a great deal of money, an indefinite suspension. For the past 5 days, I've received phone calls from promoters around this country canceling out my matches. And I haven't been able to contact anybody who will give me a match. Now, Tommy Rich, we're talking about a great deal of money. I want you to take a look at this, Gordon. I want you to take a good look at this, and I want you to take the message back to Tommy Rich. Because right here is money that I am willing to pay. And there's a great deal more where that came from. I am willing to pay these three gentlemen as an insurance policy. I may be out of wrestling indefinitely, but Tommy Rich, you are a marked man. These gentlemen and I have been in a meeting, and they have assured me that Tommy Rich's time is very, very limited. Tommy Rich, I want you to realize we're not playing games any longer. We're not playing tiddlywinks. We're very serious. George Scott can't do anything to me. The president of the NWA can't do anything to me because I've already been suspended. There's nothing anybody can do to me any longer. But these three gentlemen, they've made me a promise. They've made me a promise that they're going to get rid of you.
You know what, superstar? Tommy Rich is as good as gone.
We're professionals. No matter where the money comes from, this will make the job well done, and I assure you, Mr. Superstar, the job will be done.
I can see here $10,000 or possibly $11,000, $12,000.
There's a great deal more where that come from, Gordon. Don't you worry about it. But Tommy, you better begin to worry, and I mean today.
Well, there you have it. All of you are now informed, as Tommy has been informed, although that was his first opportunity to actually see that filmed interview.
Yes, it was, Gordon. You know, and things make a whole lot more sense now. I was wondering before, you know, what business it was of Stevens and Kamada and Mr. Mephisto, and I guess money talks. But the thing is, the superstar is gone. The superstar is gone. So all that's left here in Georgia right now, Gordon, is Mephisto, Kamada, and Ray Stevens. And there's three of them. But right here, I got my mystery man. And I ain't going to bring him out. He's probably the low-downest guy, the nastiest, the craziest, and the meanest. And most of all, he's one of the most unpredictable men you've ever seen in your life. And he is a good friend of mine. I'll say that too, Gordon. I'll say he's a very good personal friend of mine. And just like I said, Mephisto, he's the most crazy, unpredictable man that you've ever seen in your life. And if you hadn't met him at the Omni,
You're gonna meet him, because that's when I'm gonna bring him out of his box. Now, if you don't think there's nobody in it, and you want to come on out here and find out right now, we can do it now. But if you ain't got the guts, you ain't going to see him till I'm there. And I don't think you got the guts to begin with, because the only time you guys come out when my back is turned. So just like I said, right here he is, Mephisto. Y'all want to try? Behind me, that's where it's all happening. You better be ready. Mephisto, I've got the meanest, most unpredictable man that you've ever seen. And exciting, he's exciting. He can do it all. And at the Omni, you're going to find out just who he is. And y'all better be ready at the Omni for one hell of a fight. Because I guarantee you, that's exactly what it's going to be, baby. It ain't going to be no wrestling match. We coming to fight, brother, at the Omni.
On Sunday the 18th. I guess the one man who holds the greatest international reputation as a manager, a mentor, an instructor, you name it, this man does it and does it so well. Obviously, he is extremely disliked by a lot of people, but one has to recognize his genius when it comes to getting the very most out of an athlete. You can see this in coaches. You can see it throughout any athlete's career. Many times it takes that other person to draw the very best out of him, or the very worst, whichever way you happen to want to look at it. Well, this gentleman to my right, Mr. Gary Hart, has that capability. And, of course, as we saw last week, the great Kabuki in action. I've had a lot of questions, Mr. Hart. First of all, welcome to Georgia and Georgia.
Thank you very much. It's nice to be back into Atlanta, Georgia.
I've had a lot of questions regarding the fact that Kabuki, of course, always wears the face paint. Would you care to relate to the people the reason for that?
Well, the basic reason that Kabuki has taken the name as Kabuki is because in Singapore he had a match with a man by the name of Tigerjeet Singh, where the object of the match was that there was a bed of hot coals. I know that sounds ridiculous, and you would never see anything like that in America, but I'm talking about Asia and India, where life is a little harder. And the object of the match was to put the man's back across the hot coals for the 1-2-3 so he would carry the mark for life. Kabuki won the match, but the Hindu had some brothers with him, and they put Kabuki's face into the hot coals, and it burnt Kabuki's face around the eye area. That is why Kabuki's face is painted. One other important thing that I want everyone to remember. Kabuki, every time you see him, he is different. You know what Kabuki is. A lot of you people don't understand Kabuki, but in a few minutes, you are going to see the most, I would say, the greatest attraction in wrestling today. Nobody like him. We're not here for belts. We're not here for titles. We're here for money. And that's all I'd like to say right now.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hart.
Very nice. See you again.
All right, sir. Gary Hart, a man of unusual intelligence, an international traveler, and now bringing Kabuki into the ring. And this is our first experience in seeing this man here live on Georgia Championship Wrestling, being assisted into the ring now, and we'll turn it over to our ring announcer.
Thank you, Gordon. Ladies and gentlemen, this special attraction match, one fall with a 10-minute time limit, from Samoa, at 230 pounds, making his first appearance, Tony Tosi. Tony Tosi. His opponent, managed by Playboy Gary Hart, from Singapore, at 245 pounds, here is Kabuki. Kabuki.
Okay, and of course, you heard the title that Gary Hart has held over these years. Playboy Gary Hart, of course, the originally from Chicago, has extremely wealthy parents, and now Kabuki. Wearing a mask to begin with, and his head wrapped in a... unusual individual expelling some sort of a green fog, if you will. And note the hands of Kabuki. They, too, the green paint and, of course, the face. And Kabuki suddenly explodes on Tosi. And this Samoan making his first appearance, a brawl lad, no doubt about that. But Kabuki just closes in on the man. Kabuki catches him again. And so Kabuki, living up to everything that we've heard about him thus far, just continually moves against the man. And as the Samoan caught him, it was Kabuki catching him once again in the throat. Kabuki chopping to the back of the head. And Kabuki obviously just completely befuddles his opponent because of his unusual actions in the ring. Another chop to the back of the skull. And again, you can hear perhaps comments from Playboy Gary Hart. Variation of a hip roll there, and Kabuki again. Those green painted hands and the painted face obviously have to create additional problems for an opponent going in there. On a one-on-one competition, the psychological warfare becomes increasingly important as well. And Kabuki, I think anybody would admit, is a rather frightening sight. The green mouth, the green teeth. An awesome individual. And notice the dexterity with which he handles his feet and legs. And Tossie has been driven down to the canvas. Tossie, I am sure, of course, coming from Samoa, is very, very familiar with the various forms of rituals, but perhaps never having faced anybody with quite the ritualistic experience of this man, Kabuki. There you see Gary Hart, the deliberately shaven, bald pate of Gary Hart, entering the lower part of the picture from time to time. Again, he moves in, issues nothing but comments. And now Tossie firing back at Kabuki, and wait a second here. We may have a complete change of a situation as Kabuki up against those ropes, evidencing some fatigue here. Tossie tried to move him away, could not, and Kabuki catches him again. And the green paint from Kabuki beginning to spread itself over the body of Tossie. Tossie, battling gamely now, comes, brings him off the ropes, but Kabuki again using the flat of the foot. And again, you can hear the voice of Playboy Gary Hart issuing apparently instructions. I don't understand the language at all or what he's saying, but I heard him say Savat. So Savat, obviously, he would be talking about then. That's it, the Savat-type kick with the foot. And so, an interesting situation with the great Kabuki. And he is obviously had much of his... And wait a second, a problem here now with the referee. And the referee indicating Kabuki is the winner, but apparently Hart warning the referee not to put his hands on Kabuki. And a strange individual, a very, very strange individual indeed. And one almost wonders if more than just the face itself was injured by those hot coals. But nonetheless, the winner in most impressive fashion, the great Kabuki.
Hitler, Mussolini, Tojo.
We're going to be seeing George Wells in action in just a moment in a one-fall, 10-minute time limit match. I wanted to take a couple of moments, if I could, to call Michael Hayes back out. He said I wanted to talk to him about several things, including what happened earlier.
Hold it just a second here, Gordon. Sony, I want to carry this just one step further. You know, it's like this, Gordon Sully. It don't matter where we go. It don't matter if we're in Columbus, Ohio. It don't matter if we're in Atlanta, Georgia. It don't matter if we're in Tifton, Georgia, Columbus, Georgia. Michael Hayes, I want to let you know this, boy. Somewhere, I'm going to get you down. And I'm going to beat the hell out of you, Michael Hayes. You're going to get this bottle. You're going to get it embarrassed just like I did, boy.
Well, and a very irate Terry Gordy. There you heard it. And Michael Hayes on his way, the original Freebird. And may I just say about Mr. Hayes that If you were intending to raise the ire of one Terry Gordy, you've done it now.
Well, you know, it's like this. You see, look at these scars on this head that you already put on there. You see, you keep doing it, and I keep busting him, but that's getting a little bit old. What I want to do is humiliate you so bad.
Well, Sunday the 18th, you'll have...
That's right, in the Omni. Now, did he make a challenge to me that he said that I can't beat him up bad enough to put that thing on by myself? Well, then your mama raised a fool, boy. Because I can beat you up just as bad as I want. Now, see, I got him just where I want. I humiliated him. I embarrassed him. And I want you to come at me as hard as you want. Because what we're going to do is just get down just as bad and as hard as we can, Gordon. Because there's no way you're going to stick no bottle in my mouth. There is no way in hell you'll stick a bottle in my mouth. So you come with everything you got.
Here's a complete rundown.
Rockmart, Georgia.
Here's the rundown.
Attention wrestling fans, on the 18th, such stars as Otis Sistrunk and many more, including Big Jim Duggan against Steve-O. Midgets match, Little Tokyo against Cowboy Lang. George Wells against the Great Kabuki. In the grudge match of the year, Michael Hayes against Terry Gordy. Tag team event, it's now Wildfire Tommy Rich and the Mystery Partner against Tor Kamada, managed by the Great Mephisto and Ray Stevens. And for the World Heavyweight Championship, Nature Boy Ric Flair champion against the American Dream Dusty Rhodes. Get your tickets early for great seats. The Omni Atlanta.
There's the bell. Jim Gallagher moving out against George Wells. Wells in the wine red trunks moving up behind. Caught Gallagher. Zipping right hand has stunned him. Went up, flying head scissors, brought Gallagher right down to the canvas, and Gallagher stunned from that. Wells catches him again, beautiful shoulder smash, and Gallagher driven back. A count of three, and it is all over. It is all over, an almost record time for George Wells, who just exploded on Gallagher. Caught him with that head scissors, brought him straight down to the canvas, caught him then with a shoulder block, drove him back to the canvas again, and I still think that Mr. Gallagher's trying to figure out what happened to him. Well, we're talking a few moments ago at the beginning of the program, of course, about the fact that Ric Flair, the Nature Boy, has won the World Heavyweight Wrestling Championship sanctioned by the National Wrestling Alliance. Let's turn now to these videotape comments by Ric Flair.
All the great world champions of the past, you line them all up, you mix them all up, you put them all together, and they still all come up short of Ric Flair. The man born with a golden spoon. Anything in life he ever wanted, if he couldn't buy it, he went out and took it. The one thing that I wanted more than anything else, I didn't buy this to anybody. I went out there and I took this. And you think about it long and hard. I'm a great athlete, the finest physical specimen on the face of the earth. Ask any woman in town, in any town in the country. There's only one Nature Boy, woo, and nobody does it finer. Now you think about it. The world champion. Brother, when I call myself the world champion, I'm calling myself the greatest piece of work in wrestling today. Think about it. Atlanta, the 18th, Dusty Rhodes, the man that I took this from, thinks he's got it together, and he thinks he can come riding into Atlanta, riding real high with all his famous fans. Well, Big Dust, I don't care whether the people like me or not. I'm their champion. This is my belt. But they're going to have to learn to live with it. And the 18th Big Dust, I'm going to take you apart piece by piece just for Atlanta, Georgia. Woo!
Planning.
Two-times World Heavyweight Wrestling Champion Dusty Rhodes had these comments regarding the world title.
About. And in the Omni, on the 18th, in the first return match, Dusty Rhodes will be World Heavyweight Champion once again, because the major conflict here is a kid that became World Heavyweight Champion twice, defeated the meanest man in the world twice, and now all I got to do is pat your backside and pin you in the Omni on the 18th. Rhodes will be World Heavyweight Champion again, Daddy.
Okay, we're going to be back in just 5 minutes. We'll be seeing Tommy Wildfire Rich wrestling, too, and a host of others in action. Right now, though, let's catch up on all the college football scores. Here's my good friend Bob Neal with all the scores. Bob? Georgia Championship Wrestling, and I can assure you we've got a lot of action in store for you. We're going to be seeing Tommy Wildfire Rich and talking to him momentarily. Terry Gordy also wrestling too. Steve-O. We'll be seeing Ray Stevens and Tar Kamada in action as a tag team combination. And right now, as you can see, Tommy Wildfire Rich has joined me along with,
I guess who?
Really? Guess who?
Yes, sir. You know, first of all, Gordon, I'd like to say hi to all the people in Orlando, Florida, and thank them for the warm welcome I had there. And, you know, there's a couple other places. I've been getting a lot of fan mail, and I'm fixing to go on tour. It's going to be at Columbus, Ohio, Chattanooga, Tennessee, Marietta, and Gadsden, Alabama. I want to say hi to all the people in all them towns and tell them I'm looking forward to coming because my mystery man and me. Yes, sir. You know, and who's been laying low today? I ain't seen Mephisto or Ray Stevens or Kamada. None of them. They ain't none of them got the guts to come out today. What's the matter, Gordon? And you know, as far as for the superstar, he can lay all the money out on Tommy Rich's head he wants. Because just like I said, Georgia's my home, and ain't nobody running me out no more. And as far as the suspension, that wasn't my choice either, superstar. I wish they'd lifted right now because I'd like to have you back here. But they can't, or they won't. So anyway, Gordon, I'd just like to say there's a whole lot of things going on, and there's a lot of people wondering who my mystery man is. You know, and the challenge is still there. Like I said, where's Mephisto and Ray Stevens and Kamada? You know, I'm out here all by myself. Neither, Gordon. He's
not
still
quite.
Here. He's still here. My mystery man is here. And all I got to say is, anytime, any place, me and my mystery man's going to be there.
Fair enough. Thank you so very much, Tommy Wildfire Rich. Well, we're going to have a match in just a moment. Here's our ring announcer.
Ladies and gentlemen, this event, one fall with a 10-minute time limit, one fall 10, from Chicago, Illinois, at 224 pounds. Here's Ken Woodby. Ken Woodby. His opponent from California at 225 pounds, here's Brian St. John. The referee is Nick Patrick. We'll be back with this match after this brief timeout.
There's the bell. Ken Woodby going up against Brian St. John. One fall, 10-minute time limit. Brian St. John with the black trunks. Woodby with the stars on the legs of his trunks. St. John started to drop in for a single leg pickup. Good back out by Woodby. All right, it is Woodby now with the L-arm drag on St. John. All right, Woodby back on his feet now. Brian St. John circling his man. The lockup collar and elbow, and it's St. John getting to the side now, getting into a side headlock. A side chancery, rather. Takes him to the canvas. Brian St. John continues to hold the advantage here on Woodby. St. John, originally from Fort Lauderdale, Florida. Now, look at a good rear chin lock that took Woodby off his feet, back to the canvas once again. Woodby, an exceptionally deceptive opponent, very dangerous.
Come on,
takedown. Whitby breaks it up now, drove both feet into the chest of Brian St. John, and St. John now looking at his man, once again sizing him up, and realizing that Whitby can be dangerous. All right, collar and elbow, and a good move as Brian St. John slipped away from what could have been a side headlock, got the duck under and takedown. Back into the ropes, both men back on their feet, a good clean break. Brian St. John, who has been sidelined with injuries, but back in action once again, tore up his ankle. Of course, ankles and knees, shoulders and elbows, these are sometimes the very first to go. Most professional wrestlers, after years of competition in the ring, end up with rather serious back problems. Head scissors by Whitby on Brian St. John. He's caught it well in the hollow of the knee as well, so Brian St. John is going to be hard-pressed to escape from this. Nick Patrick, the referee, watching him. Chant being picked up by the crowd now. Let's go, look, Brian, let's go.
Let's go, Brian, let's go. Let's
go. All right, collar and elbow once again. Now, Woodby gets the side headlock on Brian St. John. Woodby, shorter in stature. Has remarkable strength and is exceptionally dangerous. Would be keeping that side headlock. Keeps the pressure on St. John. St. John would like to figure an escape and a counter here if he can. All right, off the ropes, drops to the canvas. Brian St. John, ooh, caught him that time. Used the elbow and forearm very effectively on Woodby. And now St. John has him a full body slam on Ken Woodby. Play by St. John as Woodby driven to the canvas once again, and St. John drives a knee into the chest of Ken Woodby, and it is Woodby coming up rather slowly. Bottom with an elbow into the chest of Ken Woodby. Brian St. John, and a real feeling of dominance here, as you can tell, evidenced by the physical body language of Brian St. John. St. John appears to be totally confident at this point. So apparently he can feel the strength and the energy waning from the body of Woodby. And of course, this is something, well executed salto. A lot of wrestling coaches still call that a gut wrench. It is basically a salto as the actual maneuver. Woodby now exploding with right hand. Brian St. John fires back. Woodby catches him again. Brian St. John, side headlock into a short chopping right hand. Brian St. John in behind his man. Caught him with a knee coming off the ropes, and Woodby driven back to the canvas again. Brian St. John, lateral press. Woodby comes out of it. A forearm by Woodby, another forearm that has St. John possibly in trouble now, as St. John hanging onto those ring ropes, and Woodby continues to fire away. St. John trying to get it together, drives the point of the toe into the midsection of Ken Woodby now. Caught him. Bear hug into a power slam. Vertical press. An extremely well executed move. Bear hug into the power slam by Brian St. John, and he is victorious over Ken Woodby. Well, you know, Ric Flair, of course, has joined the ranks of those exalted names of NWA World Heavyweight Champions. And Ric Flair, of course, is going to do everything he can to maintain that title just as long as he can. As he said, it was his for the taking any time that he decided to take it. He is an extremely confident man, perhaps a little bit overconfident. Let's listen now to these words from Ric Flair.
You think it's easy? Travel all around the world? Be considered one of the most beautiful human beings on the face of this earth? Knowing that every wrestler, every athlete in the world today would like to be in my place. But I don't care if it's St. Louis. I don't care if it's the great city of Atlanta. the wrestling capital of Columbus, Ohio, Greensboro, Miami, Tampa, makes no difference. Wherever Ric Flair is, things are going down. Because everybody wants to be sitting where the nature boy is. 8 long years, blood, sweat, yeah, and a few tears, brought me this big gold trophy. And nobody, nobody in the wrestling world is going to take it from me very, very easily. Think about it. Ric Flair, a legend in his own time. Mr. Cool, that's what they call me. When I walk the street, the ladies say, woo, he is some kind of fine. And he is our world champion. Now, Columbus, Ohio, I'm coming again. And you know what I'm talking about. And then, the 18th, Atlanta, Georgia. The big time. My kind of town, my kind of women, my kind of style. Limousines, bright lights, woo! Atlanta, Georgia, the 18th. The American dream, Dusty Rhodes, the son of a plumber. The man that I had to slap around and take this belt from because I wanted it. I wanted it more than he did, and I went out and got it. Now, ladies and gentlemen, whether you like it or not, Ric Flair, in all his magnificence, is your world champion. And the 18th, the Omni, Big Dust, I don't care how bad you are. And the 18th, woo, you're going to belong to the Nature Boy all night long. Woo!
Attention wrestling fans, on the 18th, such stars as Otis Sistrunk, and many more, including Big Jim Duggan against Steve-O, Midgets Match, Little Tokyo against Cowboy Lang, George Wells against the Great Kabuki, and the grudge match of the year, Michael Hayes against Terry Gordy. Tag team event, it's now Wildfire Tommy Rich and the Mystery Partner against Tor Kamata, managed by the Great Mephisto and Ray Stevens. And for the World Heavyweight Championship, Nature Boy Ric Flair champion against the American Dream Dusty Rhodes. Get your tickets early for great seats, the Omni Atlanta.
Something most unusual happened during another hour of Georgia Championship Wrestling that I think all of you might be interested in sharing with me at this particular time. I had been talking to Terry Gordy when suddenly Michael Hayes came out. He had a baby bottle and a bonnet with him. Well, as we were talking, the situation looked very much like it was going to get completely out of hand, which it did. I cut away to a commercial, and it just so happened that, of course, the cameras were still on. And although at that particular moment none of you could see it who are now viewing us at home, but we did have it on videotape. Well, I played that particular incident back when Mike Hayes, Otis Sistrunk, and Terry Gordy got tangled up and sort of got things going with the baby bonnet and the bottle. I played that back, and then Terry Gordy came out very, very upset about the entire incident and the entire situation. I thought you might enjoy watching that situation as it did occur once again. So let's go back in time now. And mind you, I am now showing the part where Terry Gordy has the bonnet put on his head.
Wait a second here. Wait a second, Terry Gordy, they're putting me. They put a baby bonnet on him and they shoved a baby bottle in his mouth. Wow!
Well, that's what happened that those of you at home did not get an opportunity to see Terry Gordy came out.
Wait just a second, Gordon. Sorry, I don't appreciate it one little bit. You showing this film back on Nationwide TV. I don't appreciate being treated like this, Gordon Sully. I'm a professional athlete, and I want to be treated like a professional athlete. It's like this, Gordon Sully. Michael's been going around here and calling me names and calling me everything for a long time now, and I'm getting good and tired of it. You know, it's like this, Michael Hayes. I don't know if you're anywhere back there listening or not, boy, but I got something to tell you, and I want you to clean your ears up and clean them out good, boy.
It's like this. I bet you can't. I bet he ain't man enough, Gordon Solie. I bet he ain't man enough to take this bottle and take this body and stick it in my mouth itself, you know. Gordon Solie, if I could only get my hands on him right now, I would beat him like a red-headed stepchild, because Michael Hayes, I ain't ever got your body, boy. And one day, Michael Hayes, I'm gonna pay you back, boy, because you know I've did a lot of things for you. I brought you out of the slums of Pensacola, Florida, and made you what you are today. So, Michael Hayes, you know, it's like this, Gordon Solie. You just don't do something like this and embarrass me on nationwide TV and think for one second that you're gonna get away with it. Because, Michael Hayes, if it takes everything I got, boy, I'm going to beat every brain in your body out.
Well, perhaps one day they will meet one-on-one, and we'll find out who is the better man, Michael Hayes or Terry Gordy. We'll be right back. There's the bell. Jim Underhill moving out against Terry Gordy. One fall, 10 minutes time limit. Gordy locks up, and Underhill very quickly moved behind him. Got a waist-width takedown. Close to the arm. A good ride by Underhill. Terry Gordy turns into his man. Single leg pickup with a back leg trip. And Gordy now with a ride on Underhill. Underhill trying to set out an escape. Back to his feet. A good escape by Underhill. So you've got Underhill at about 245 pounds, and Terry Gordy duck under go behind takedown. Started for a possible Oklahoma roll there, and Underhill slipped away from it. Underhill again, trying to sit out and escape back to his feet. They're into the ring ropes. I'll tell you what. That's rather interesting. Let's take a very, very close look here. Duck under, go behind. A waist drag takedown by Terry Gordy. Gordy keeping, look at the way he ties up those legs. I'll tell you what, for all of his size and his sometimes bombacity, and you can hear the crowd shouting, we want Michael. They would like to see Michael Hayes and Terry Gordy mixing it up right now. Terry Gordy keeping the waist cinch on him, back into the ring ropes. The referee calls for the break. All right, collar and elbow. Jim Underhill with a side headlock on Terry Gordy. Underhill keeping that side headlock. Terry Gordy, better than 270 pounds, 6'4", big man, tough. But Underhill, powerful legs, as you can see, powerful upper body. Collar and elbow, and it's Underhill once again with a side headlock on Terry Gordy. And you can hear some partisan fans out there. There they are, and they're very much in league. He caught him. He caught him with that one punch. I'll tell you something about this man, Terry Gordy. He showed me a new side. Terry Gordy showed me a completely new side to his capabilities in the ring. Every time in the past I've watched him come out there, he has been just about as roughshod a wrestler as you'd expect to find. But he showed remarkable wrestling ability. Some good rides, some good waist drag takedowns, and exploded with that right hand. It was all over for Mr. Underhill. But Mr. Gordy, I think, has proven beyond a shadow of a doubt that he has all of the basics necessary to go with that 270-pound body, and what a collision that's going to be. Let me take a couple of moments right now. Earlier in the program, at the very onset of this hour, Mr. Rich was wondering about the whereabouts of you and these two gentlemen.
You know, the whereabouts of these two gentlemen and the great Mephisto, we will show in the Omni. You know, they have a quaint American word here that they call punks. And I didn't know exactly what that word meant, but I know now that Tommy Rich is American punk. We don't like surprises, and we do not like secrets. Now, it seems that Tommy Rich
has taken upon himself to regroup, what you might say, and find some friends, if he possibly can, to pit them against Ray Stevens and Tor Kamada. But this will not be the easiest thing. To face these two would be like getting on a jet plane and flying into the eye of a hurricane.
You know what? Tommy Rich said that we come out here and jumped on his back. I didn't see no tape on his back. It was right on his face.
Well, on the 18th of the Omni. All right.
The Omni, listen, I don't think he's got anybody or anything in that box.
It's probably there's Steve-O or that goofy Michael Hayes.
Why, there's nobody goofy enough to team up with him, especially when they know what's on his head. When they know that Ray Stevens and Tor Kamada and the great Mephisto are going to absolutely put you out of the wrestling business, Tommy Rich. And we don't care who you got. You think you're scaring us with that box there? You haven't got anybody in the box.
Well, there was obviously somebody in there because they were rapping back. But nonetheless, I might just point out to all of you, of course, that tickets are currently on sale at the Omni All Seats locations for Sunday, October 18th. The World Heavyweight Champion Ric Flair defends his title against Dusty Rhodes, and these two against Tommy Wildfire Rich and a mystery partner.
Oh, I'm going to tell you what, he's going to have a few more bandages, and they're going to be elsewhere besides his nose. You're going to have bandages all over your body, Tommy Rich, and if you can get anybody to wrestle with you, they'll have them too.
There's the bell. Wrestling 2 and Steve-O, tag team partners now against the combination of Ken Timms and Tomahawk Thompson. And it's Ken Timms out there. Steve-O has him in a side headlock, makes a quick tag with Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 moves in behind his man. Overhooks those arms, catches him coming off. Timms tried to skirt around him and get him away, and 2 caught him, and Timms now drove that knee into the ring apron. He's got some problems now. He's going to have some problems with that left leg and that back as Steve-O makes the tag. Timms in trouble. Steve-O on him very quickly once again. Steve-O, a chop across the throat. Steve-O tried for a quick pin. Timms, too fresh, moved away. Side headlock by Timms. Timms makes the tag with Tomahawk Thompson. Belly to back to play. Excellent execution that time by Steve-O. By the way, we've got some outstanding standby matches today in the event we need them, including the great Kabuki. Wow, Wrestling 2 punishing Tomahawk immediately. All right, moves in, lateral press. Tomahawk manages to get away from it, and it is Wrestling 2 back on him very quickly yet. Again, and it is Ken Timms moving back out against Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2, quick duck under, go behind, makes the tag, has his man tied up, keeps him in that corner. Steve-O started to go for a full Nelson, reverts now to a snapmare, then drives the knee into the chest of Ken Timms. Timms back on the canvas, Steve-O lateral press. Into the ropes, Ken Timms utilizing those ring ropes very effectively. Get it in, Timms. Brothers who have had quite a career in amateur sports and beginning to make a mark for themselves in the ranks of pro wrestling. But right now, Steve-O, that avalanche, it pulls those hamstrings. Tag is made once again. Wrestling 2 crashes down across the upper thigh. Catching those quadricep femoris muscles, then it is Wrestling 2 now with a toehold on Timms. Continues to punish him. Talking to Freddie Miller the other day about the fact that Wrestling 2 has become even a tougher competitor than he was in the past. There is a new really killer instinct in the man now, and Steve-O beginning to develop that same attitude.
One, two,
Tim's now trying to extricate himself, wrestling too, keeping that leg tied up. Tim's is going to have a lot of problems on that left leg. He injured it early on in the match, and now they are really concentrating on it. Both Steve-O and wrestling too, after that leg, continuing to punish the left leg. Tim's is going to be hard-pressed to utilize that. Tim, suddenly in desperation, rips across the face and tags up, goes back, gets in another shot on Steve-O. Steve-O makes the tag with Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 drives a knee into the femoris muscles again of Tomahawk Thompson. Now a toe hold. Notice the way that boot is being twisted here. And once again, it is Steve-O, an inside step over, and Steve-O pressing that advantage. One would have to look at Steve-O and Wrestling 2 and consider them both certainly top contenders for a title match for the World Heavyweight Championship. There's certainly no question about that, regardless of who is champion, be it the current champion Ric Flair, or should anybody defeat him. Whoever it is, of course, would have to take up the contract of the champion. And Ric Flair has had a good drop toe hold by Steve-O. Makes the tag with Wrestling 2. A lot of men looking to regain that title, and a lot of men looking to gain it for the first time. Steve-O and Wrestling 2 both looking to get the World Heavyweight Championship. Dusty Rhodes, twice World Heavyweight Champion, would like to regain that title for a third time. And Tomahawk, having his problems as Steve-O tags up. Tomahawk limping noticeably now. And again, Steve-O closes in on that leg. And this is the thing. If you know that your man is hurt, you might as well close in on that point. Recently, when the Bucks quarterback, Doug Williams, was knocked out of a play, and they thought perhaps he had a concussion, but it fired everybody up. He came back in and was twice as effective. Well, perhaps Mr. Thompson will have that opportunity, but right now Steve-O trying to decimate him. Makes the tag. Wrestling 2 caught him right in the pit of the stomach, so they're changing their attack now. Once again, the tag is made, and Steve-O caught him, a double thrust. Off the rope, Steve-O caught a beautiful flying drop kick, makes the tag very quickly with Wrestling 2. Wrestling 2 sets in the corner. You can see him setting, and Tomahawk coming up very slowly indeed. Wrestling 2 charges in that million-dollar knee lift into a lateral press. A count of three, it is all over. And a fine victory for the combination of Wrestling 2 and Steve-O. Well, by now, it's certainly no secret that the superstar has put out a rather large sum of money and has offered it particularly to Ray Stevens, Torquemada, and the great Mephisto to see if they can't end the wrestling career of one Tommy Wildfire Rich. As you know, the superstar has been suspended nationwide. And as I showed earlier on an earlier program, the superstar flew me to Atlanta and held a conversation with me that he specifically requested that I bring back to Tommy Wildfire Rich and to all of you, the viewing public. So right now, let's take another look at that interview that I held with the superstar regarding Tommy Rich.
But there's not a thing that I can do for you.
Gordon, I don't want you to do a thing for me. All I want you to do is, because I know that Tommy Rich respects you a great deal, and I've respected you in the past, I want you to take back a message, and this is directed to you, Tommy Rich. You have cost me a great deal of money. An indefinite suspension. For the past 5 days, I've received phone calls from promoters around this country canceling out my matches. And I haven't been able to contact anybody who will give me a match. Now, Tommy Rich, we're talking about a great deal of money. I want you to take a look at this, Gordon. I want you to take a good look at this, and I want you to take the message back to Tommy Rich. Because right here is money that I am willing to pay, and there's a great deal more where that came from. I am willing to pay these three gentlemen as an insurance policy. I may be out of wrestling indefinitely,
But Tommy Rich, you are a marked man. These gentlemen and I have been in a meeting, and they have assured me that Tommy Rich's time is very, very limited. Tommy Rich, I want you to realize we're not playing games any longer. We're not playing tiddlywinks. We're very serious. George Scott can't do anything to me. The president of the NWA can't do anything to me because I've already been suspended. There's nothing anybody can do to me any longer but these three gentlemen. They've made me a promise. They've made me a promise that they're going to get rid of you.
You know what, superstar? Tommy Rich is as good as gone.
We're professionals. No matter where the money comes from, this will make the job well done, and I assure you, Mr. Superstar, the job will be done.
I can see here $10,000 or possibly $11,000, $12,000.
There's a great deal more where that come from, Gordon. Don't you worry about it. But Tommy, you better begin to worry, and I mean today.
Well, there you have it. So the superstar is suspended nationwide, but nonetheless, it is Tommy Wildfire Rich who is the target of all of this money, and it's going to be interesting to see exactly what does happen. I can assure you this. They talk about being professionals. Tommy Rich is certainly a professional. I feel he's going to hold his own in this situation. Let's take a look at wrestling around the country. Here's Freddie Miller.
Thanks, Gordon. On Sunday, October 25th, Columbus, Ohio at 7:30 at the Ohio Center. Tickets now on sale at the center at all five major Columbus Lazarus stores. That afternoon in Huntington, West Virginia, 2 o'clock at the Memorial Fieldhouse. A great card of Battle Royal to meet the world champion that day at the Fieldhouse. On the 24th, Piedmont, Alabama, the high school. The 23rd, Cartersville, Georgia, the Cherokee Street Gym. The 22nd, Cleveland, Georgia, Truett McConnell Gym. On the 21st, Columbus, Georgia. The 20th, Dawsonville, Georgia. Next Saturday, Carrollton, Georgia. Next Friday, Gainesville, Georgia, the Georgia Mountain Center. And Gunnersville, Alabama. Next Thursday, Hawkinsville and Trenton, Georgia. Tuesday, Thomaston, Georgia. Monday night, Augusta Bell Auditorium. Tomorrow night at 8, that's Marietta, the Cobb County Civic Center. Tomorrow at 3, Chattanooga. Tonight, the Coliseum in Gadsden, Alabama and Rockmart, Georgia. Here's the full card for the Omni next Sunday, the 18th. Watch. Attention wrestling fans, on the 18th, such stars as Otis Sistrunk and many more, including Big Jim Duggan against Steve-O. Midgets match, Little Tokyo against Cowboy Lang, George Wells against the Great Kabuki, and the grudge match of the year, Michael Hayes against Terry Gordy. Tag team event, it's now Wildfire Tommy Rich and the Mystery Partner against Tor Kamada, managed by the Great Mephisto and Ray Stevens. And for the World's Heavyweight Championship, Nature Boy Ric Flair champion against the American Dream Dusty Rhodes. Get your tickets early for great seats, the Omni Atlanta.
There's the bell. Ray Stevens and Tor Kamada moving out against Scott Dumas and Bruce Gallagher. Correction, against Dave Jacobs and Rick Thor. I'm sorry. Dave Jacobs outside the ring. That's Rick Thor in the ring right now against Tor Kamada. Kamada with a quick chop to the side of the neck. Kamada catches him in the side of the neck and around the shoulder area once again. Ooh, and there's where amazing speed from this man who goes well over 300 pounds. You notice the way that foot just flashed right to the chest. As him up, smashes him into that turnbuckle and makes the a series of whistles by the great Mephisto that keeps the situation in hand. Ray Stevens, having made the tag, overhooks the head of Rick Thor. Now, beautiful double underhook takedown by Stevens. He had both arms underhooked and brought him around. And Thor trying to escape from that. Stevens caught with an arm drag. Look at the way Stevens moves in on this man, though. Beautiful lateral drop in. Picked up one leg, a back trip on the other leg. Now the tag is made. Abe Jacobs moves in. Abe Jacobs from New Zealand, and he is a double tough individual. Jacobs back on his feet. Jacobs watching his man. Tor Kamada makes the tag. When you talk about being in shape, Abe Jacobs is just that. Good high hip lock takedown by Kamada. Jacobs on the canvas. Jacobs back to his feet. Good escape by Jacobs. Gets the arm drag and twist on Kamada. Kamada with a chop to the side of the neck. And whistle again. There's a thrust directly into the throat, a headbutt to the midsection. And Jacobs now. Perhaps might be thinking rather seriously of getting over and tagging up. That's exactly what he's trying to do, and the referee trying to keep them separated. No, sir, Jacobs moved toward one corner, and Stevens moved in on him. Stevens, who has been in the pro ranks for a while, as has Jacobs and Kamala. And Stevens smashed into that turnbuckle, having his problems coming back to his feet. Rick Thor caught him. Now the tag is made, and Thor has Ray Stevens as his adversary here, using that forearm. Stevens drops down to the basics again, tried to sweep a leg. Thor had too solid a stance. Now Thor drops to both knees. Good block. Stevens turned that to his own advantage now. Drove that shoulder into the chest and made the tag with Thor Kamada. Kamada moves back in. Brings Thor up. Full body slam. You'll notice a rather unusual stance with Thor Kamada. Again, smashing Rick Thor into that turnbuckle. And catching him in the lumbar region like that, putting a definite strain on the spinal column, and it is Thor back to the canvas. Thor Kamada, seemingly impervious to the warnings from the referee. And Thor trying desperately to fight back now, trying to battle his way back to the corner. Ray Stevens having made the tag. Stevens continues that punishment. Thor now would like very much to get over and tag up. Stevens still dominating the situation. Stevens brings him up. Full body power slam. And Stevens now, the tag, Thor Kamada catches him. It is all over as Thor Kamada, better than 300 pounds of Japanese fury, crashing down across the chest of Rick Thor. So the victors, Thor Kamada and Ray Stevens.
Well, Michael Hayes and Tommy Wildfire Rich are two men who have a lot on their minds right now and a lot of scores to settle. Tommy Rich, of course, who does not want the man superstar suspended. He'd like to have him back in action, but he has been suspended. You can see that Tommy Rich and Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk are joining me. Well, we're back with... Okay, there's four of us, five of us here right now.
Yes, sir, at least five. I might have two or three guys in there, Gordon. You never know.
Well, that's a fact. And here are the new Georgia Tag Team Champions, Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk.
You know something, Gordon Soul, it seems that there's still a few people around here that don't like Michael Hayes. Let me tell you something, sweetheart. I never needed no broad like that to get behind me, baby, because all I need is my big man, Otis Badman Sistrunk. Now check that out, mama. Whoa.
Well, I'll tell you what, let's talk to Tommy Wildfire Rich right now about the 18th. Because you do have a tag team match against Ray Stevens and Thor Kamada.
You know, that's exactly right, Gordon. Seemed like a whole lot of things. I've seen Big Baby Hewitt with a bottle stuck in his mouth. There's a whole lot of things going on here in Georgia. And the main thing is, you know, Gordon, I made the people a promise. I promised I was going to win the world title. I did that. I made a promise I was going to beat the superstar for the national heavyweight title, and I did this. Now then, I'm making another promise. When I said I had the most unpredictable, crazy man that you'd ever seen in your life, well, that's a promise. I'm making the people a promise. They're not going to be let down. But I'm near the 18th. Mephisto, Ray Stevens, Kamada, you better be ready, because I'm going to let my man out of the box. It's the Omni. If not before, if they got the guts to come out now.
Fair enough.
Whoops.
Yeah, well, let's go to the ring. Let's go to the ring. And it is Michael Hayes very quickly moving against an opponent out there. Michael Hayes exploding on Scott Dumas. And he has got Dumas in a lot of trouble. Michael Hayes hurtling Dumas back into the ring. Michael Hayes like a man possessed right now.
issuing all kinds of punishment. And now, from the Oakland Raiders, here he is, the man from Mars, Otis Sistrunk. Sistrunk now with a side headlock. And again, the tag is made. Michael Hayes moves back into the ring against Scott Dumas. Bruce Gallagher, Dumas' partner in this Australian tag team match. Michael Hayes catches him. Dumas gets over. Makes the tag with Bruce Gallagher. Now, Mr. Hayes is going to have some problems here. He lashes out with a foot to the midsection and smashes Gallagher into the fist of Otis Sistrunk. And the man from Mars is big, man, and he is doubled up. And Hayes striking out at everyone. Bruce Gallagher caught in a rear chin lock. Michael Hayes, he was sworn to get vengeance on Terry Gordy. And it is Hayes blocking a single leg pickup that time. It is Bruce Gallagher coming off. Otis Sistrunk caught him coming off the ropes and crushes him back into the turnbuckle. Sistrunk punishing Gallagher, now has Scott Dumas, and now it's Otis Sistrunk punishing both men. Sistrunk and Gallagher both bounced out of the ring by Otis Sistrunk, the man from Mars. And Sistrunk delivers the same kind of fear to the men in the wrestling ring as he used to on the football field. Scott Dumas brought up a full body slam again by Hayes. Hayes crashes down on the chest of Scott Dumas. Dumas in the red trunks has never had a chance as Hayes has just exploded. Hayes again moves in on his man. Hayes, about as mean a competitor as you'll find anywhere. Into the ropes, the referee calls for the break, and Nick Patrick warning him now for his tactic as Dumas comes up rather slowly, caught again by Michael Hayes. And you can hear that chant, Freebird being picked up now. Michael Hayes, the original Freebird, and now Dumas, or Gallagher rather, driven into the corner with Otis Sistrunk. Gallagher off the rope, caught by Otis Sistrunk, and Sistrunk drove him back to the canvas. Side headlock by Sistrunk has Gallagher in a lot of trouble. Gallagher just hanging on. Tag is made. Michael Hayes moves back. Bruce Gallagher makes the tag, and Dumas moves in, and Michael Hayes is all over him. Hayes brings him up. Use the pile driver. All right. Michael Hayes and Otis Sistrunk victorious in this match. Let's have our standby match, please. We will need our standby match, so we can. George Scott, our matchmaker, will be sending out a standby match. That should be the great Kabuki going up against Bob McKenzie. We're going to have time for that. Let me take a moment right now. A question crossed my mind when I was watching the great Kabuki in action. And, Mr. Hart, I will place this question to you as delicately as I can. I mean, no offense to anyone involved, but it appears to me that Kabuki is a person who is almost out of control.
Well, let me just say this. Anyone's face that's been put into the hot coals, that changes your attitude. But what I mainly want to talk about, Mr. Soley, and I only need a few minutes. A few years ago, I was the number in Atlanta. And when Gary Hart talked, everybody listened. But there was a man by the name of Wrestling Number Two. Now, Number Two, I've chased you all over the Southwest, Fort Worth, Dallas. I've chased you through Florida. I've chased you through Louisiana, and I couldn't get you. But in Atlanta, Georgia, sooner or later, the boogeyman's gonna get you if you don't watch out. I'm sorry, but that's the way I feel. And number two, the only reason Gary Hart and Kabuki are in Atlanta is for you, number two, because you hurt me bad, and now I'm gonna hurt you bad. And that's all I got to say.
Fair enough, Gary Hart, the manager and mentor to the great Kabuki, and Kabuki right now going up against Bob McKenzie in this standby match. And, well, a warning has been well served by Mr. Hart on wrestling, too. So let's wait now for the bell to ring. Kabuki enters the ring, and again you see the ritualistic manner in which Kabuki always enters the ring. And constantly changing his attire, his approach, his methodology, and Kabuki now being worn by Gary Hart. Kabuki with the sticks, and these, of course, are basically lethal weapons. There's no question about that. And Hart having his problems, taking that away from Kabuki. And a face of mail on Kabuki, and Kabuki again with that green cloud emitting from his mouth. Gary Hart slips from the ring. And by now, McKenzie must be really wondering what he is facing here in an opponent. Kabuki again closes in on this man, and Kabuki, striking like a vampire, if you will, closes in on him, a series of blows to the throat that has McKenzie back to the canvas once again. And there you see it again, that green fog that emits from his mouth. Most unusual individual. And difficult to put into exact words exactly what we are seeing here in this man, Kabuki. Kabuki on that top rope crashes down on McKenzie once again. And you can hear perhaps the voice of Gary Hart continuing to issue some sort of instructions to Kabuki. McKenzie tried a headbutt to the midsection. Kabuki retaliates with a chop to the side of the head. Kabuki, beautiful savate-type blow with a kick. And it is Kabuki again with a chop to the back of the this man, McKenzie. McKenzie in trouble. And it is Hart. And, of course, Gary Hart will keep up a running monologue outside the ring. He'll talk to his man. He'll talk to the opponent. And tries to create an aura of confusion, and that's exactly what he does.
It's not the top. He's going to walk down. He's going to walk down.
Well, let's see what he's doing. Look at this man.
He walked down. He didn't
walk down the ropes. And he's saying something to Kabuki, and once again, now McKenzie fires to the midsection. McKenzie arm whips Kabuki. Kabuki caught him and almost ripped his head off. And it is Kabuki catching him again, a variation of a fireman carry, and drives that fist in Kabuki again. And this is the strange part about Kabuki. Very ceremonial. McKenzie trying to power out, could not. He was completely out of power at that particular point. And Kabuki, in that strange ritualistic spin, now being escorted from the ring area by Gary Hart, the playboy from Chicago, who has over the years brought in to professional wrestling some of the most awesome competitors I think the sport has ever seen. And again, with Kabuki, you can't help but wonder if there isn't more scars, if there aren't more scars than just those around the eyes. You wonder about mental or possible emotional scars that this man may carry with him into that squared circle. But
let me say just a couple of things. What you have witnessed here today, the man at no time ever broke one hold. He never used karate. There are five types of Chinese gung fu. tiger style, crane style, snake style, and dragon style. Each time you will see something different. And each time, number two, you're going to know. We're going to get you. If it's the last thing I do, Halloween's coming, and so is the boogeyman.
Well, there you have it. Some very serious words from Playboy Gary Hart, the manager of the Great Kabuki. That's all our time for this week. Till next week, Gordon Solie saying so long.
Thanks for watching Georgia Championship Wrestling. The announcers on this program are employed by Georgia Championship Wrestling, Incorporated. Join us again next week for Georgia Championship Wrestling.